For those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. The law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. He sent his own Son in a body like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his Son as a sacrifice for our sins. He did this so that the just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us, who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. And then skipping to verse 35. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity, or are persecuted or hungry or destitute, or are persecuted or hungry, or in danger or threatened with death? As the scriptures say, for your sake we are killed every day. We are being slaughtered like sheep. No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ, who loved us. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come before you just so thankful for your love for us, that you sent Jesus in a human body, but also 100% God, to save us from our sins. Thank you for his ruby red blood that makes us white as snow. Amen.
I belong to you. that if someone here today has not turned their life over to you and trusted in you, that they would take this great opportunity on this beautiful day to do that. Thank you again for what you've already accomplished in this service. Thank you for the blessing that you've been through your people here already, just their smiling faces and their attendance. You know about all the things that are in our hearts and minds that are concerning us, and we turn them all over to you. We ask a special blessing on Mike as he comes to share what you've laid on his heart. Help us to listen, be attentive, and apply the part that you need for us to apply to our own personal lives so that we can be better witnesses for you in this beautiful valley that we get to call home. So thank you again for who you are and your watch, care, and protection and love for us. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Youngsters, you can go to Children's Church.
If you would please, to Revelation chapter 18. As you're doing that, I just want to point out a couple little things. You might have noticed a different face up here on the stage, and I'm not going to try to embarrass Jack, but I appreciated Jack playing the drums for us today and kind of giving us some rhythm. I cannot clap and sing at the same time. I have zero sense of rhythm, but thank you for being a part of that with us. Also, Taisha, bless your heart, you are so brave. You are ready. The only thing that takes more courage to go to be a missionary in a foreign land is to get up on the same stage with Lane. Bless your heart, girl, you've done well. I appreciate it. I just pray that God will help your support and raising come in. Lauren, after that song, I just feel like closing in prayer. Thank you for sharing that with us, too. God has just given individuals, not just upfront people at our church, and we do appreciate the upfront folk, but a lot of stuff that happens behind the scenes. I was out somewhere this past week, and one of our neighbors found my phone number on our church webpage and called me and said, they just turned the irrigation water on, you got water squirting out all over your property. So I made a few phone calls, and I'm not sure who took care of it. Juan, maybe it was you or somebody else. I don't know who it was, but it just took care of itself automatically. So, no, things don't happen automatically around here. A lot of people do stuff behind the scenes, and I am so thankful to be a part of a church fellowship where that happens. Okay, if you turn, if you have your sermon notes handy, if you turn to Revelation chapter 18, we need to do a little review through the slides. Okay, so as we look at this, this is kind of a summary of the tribulation. As we look at this whole area, we looked at the whole history of the tribulation, from the rapture of the church to the seven seals, the seven trumpets, and the seven bowl judgments that happened at the same time, all up to the millennium of Christ. That's a summary of the tribulation. But right at the end of this whole scenario about the tribulation comes this whole section we've been working through in chapter 17 and 18, and it really covers a much larger span. It's spoken of toward the end of the tribulation before the millennium, but it's really kind of a summary overview of things that happened all the way through that time, and it really focuses on the doom of Babylon. There's four different messages related to that we're going through. In that, before we get there, it talks about the doom of Babylon. And in one sense, the doom of Babylon, there was this original tower that was built early on in Genesis chapter, I think it was 10. And that really was a symbol of rebellion worldwide. There is this, God has created the people, raised them up, asked them to follow him. He pulled them after the flood to spread out across the entire earth, be fruitful and multiply, and just spread godliness around the entire globe. And they got together and thought, you know, we need to build something going on here. So they started building this tower, and in direct violation of what God wanted, they wanted to stay together. We know what happened in rebellion against, and judgment against the rebellion The Lord confused their language. The construction of this tower stopped. But it was really the Tower of Babel was a visible representative of direct rebellion against God. The scarlet harlot is spoken of in Revelation chapter 17. We talked about that a little bit. It's basically kind of a false church. The scarlet harlot that rides on this beast we saw was the Antichrist, but the scarlet harlot is this false church. Will there be religion in the tribulation? Oh, there will be lots of religion, but not really a focus on a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we're going to talk more about this. But this fooling people, for people to be fooled or deceived into thinking that if I just do religion, I'm good. There's this innate thing within the heart of a lot of people. I've got to worship something. And the scarlet harlot gives them a lot of opportunity. So this basically is kind of a false church that took place during that time. We'll talk more about that as we progress this morning. And then finally, we talk about religious pluralism, which is the idea of holding God up. They did not in the Old Testament, even in the book of Hosea, and will not even during the tribulation, totally reject the God that we know of and Jesus Christ who we know of. But they will put with that, have put that, will put with that, other stuff from the world, and they'll mix worldliness with their faith in God. Pluralism or dualism. But the whole idea, people are going to be called upon to make a choice. You're going to serve God, you're going to serve the world. In fact, Jesus said you can't serve God and money at the same time. And so this whole idea, this tendency towards pluralism has crept or will creep its way into the tribulation. But folks, it is rampant in our culture right now. So that's kind of the whole idea of that. Now, in terms of this whole section on the doom of Babylon, we've talked about Babylon's description, Babylon's victor, Babylon's fall, and Babylon's lament. We've covered those first two last week and the week before, and today we're going to focus on Babylon's fall. So, if you've got your sermon notes handy, Revelation chapter 18, we're ready to go. The whole focus is on Babylon. Babylon, meaning the spirit of rebellion. Babylon is that false church idea that will become so present and rampant. So there'll be an actual city called Babylon, but within that actual city, or coming from an actual city, is this whole world system that Satan just loves to foster on the world. Is fostering it right now and will foster it to a greater degree during the tribulation. This whole idea of religious pluralism. Having God plus something else. So first of all, if we look at Revelation chapter 18, verse 1, let me just read that and we'll get on to the points of our message. Verse 1. After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and earth was illuminated with his glory. Verse 2. And he cried out with a mighty voice, saying, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a dwelling place of demons and a prison for every unclean spirit and a prison of every unclean and hateful bird. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the passion of her immorality, and the kings of the earth have committed acts of immorality with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich by the wealth of her sensuality." Oh. That's speaking of a city of Babylon, but it's speaking of a world system that is devoid of any true devotion to Christ. So let's go back and begin to take this apart a piece at a time. The first three verses here really speak about Babylon's evil. As we look at verse 1, it starts off with the phrase, "after these things." Well, what are the things it's talking about? We're having a series of successive visions that John had. Not that these visions are representative of successive points of history, but he's having one vision after another, and it covers the whole scope of what Babylon was like during the tribulation period of time and what will happen to Babylon eventually. After these things, this is a deeper way of seeing the fall of Babylon. And it talks about this angel coming, having great authority, illuminated with his glory. Now, I want us to go back and kind of take a look at this. There are some that think that this angel that has great authority and illuminating the earth with his light, with his glory, some think, well, that's Jesus. That's his second coming. He's coming again. Well, if we go back and kind of analyze some of the way that the Greek construction is put together, it says that there is another angel coming. After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven. Well, the word another, we talked about this before. There's two words for another in the Greek, whereas in English, we just have the one word. But it's another of the same kind or another of a different kind. So if we're talking about something here, like I used the illustration before, a bowl of creamed Brussels sprouts with asparagus sauce over the top. Some of you might think, whoa, that sounds good. Then there's, right beside it on the counter, is a bowl of chocolate pudding with a big dollop of vanilla ice cream on the top. So I'm sitting there, and I eat my Brussels sprouts with asparagus sauce. And then, and then I eat my bowl of chocolate pudding with the ice cream on top. And then I say to Marilyn, that was good. Can I have another bowl? Well, what's Marilyn thinking? Let's get the Brussels sprouts and the asparagus ready. But no, I want another of the same kind of what I just had, the chocolate pudding with that dollop of ice cream on top of here. So another of the same kind or another of the different kind? Well, the word that is used in this passage means another of the same kind, another angel, meaning another of the same kind. So this is another of the heavenly realms, another of the heavenly messengers of God, a little brighter, a little stronger than the ones that have come before. The last time we talked about an angel here was in chapter 17. But this angel has great power, but not all power. This angel illumines the whole world. Here he makes a global declaration. Look what happens to this global declaration in verse 2. And he cries out with a mighty voice, saying, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a dwelling place of demons, and a prison of every unclean spirit, and a prison of every unclean, hateful bird." This glorious angel makes a kind of a double declaration. Number one, Babylon has fallen, and that's the state of Babylon, or the city of Babylon, but also this world system is crumbling under God's judgment, this religious pluralism. And kind of gives the reason why God had to take Babylon and all that she represents out. She has become a dwelling place for demons. If you wanted to go to the epicenter for demons, you go to Babylon, but you hang out not just in the city on the planet Earth. You hover in this whole realm of religious pluralism. You kind of keep a smattering of what God looks like. And yet you live like the world underneath it, so that the holiness of Christ doesn't make an impact on your life. That's religious pluralism or religious dualism. And in that process, demons are hanging out. A prison for every unclean spirit. Why is this so? Well, look at verse 3. Now, my Bible begins with the English word for. And if you look that up in the Greek, usually when you have an English Bible, the word for at the beginning of the sentence, most of the time it's translated because. So you give a statement in one verse and then you tell the reason for it in the next verse. So she'd become a prison for all these unclean spirits and these hateful things and everything, verse 3, for or because all the nations have drunk of the wine of the passion of her immorality, and the kings of the earth have committed acts of immorality with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich by the wealth of her sensuality. And it really mixes up here a lot of sensuality and immorality and kind of the sexual impropriety side of things with rebellion against God. And this whole passage really speaks deeply to that. And these kings of the earth and all the nations, is not so much speaking only about their moral life or their moral integrity. It speaks about how they've all been deceived. The entire world has been deceived. People, I haven't done this for a while, but a few weeks ago I clicked the news on. I thought I was reading Revelation 17 and 18. Not that it's falling yet, but I can see that this whole world is ignoring the true God of the Bible. This whole world, including our own country, is ignoring the God that sent his son to save us from our sins. We have become so comfortable as a culture, even our culture, with religious pluralism that we're the oddball if you take a stand for what is holy and righteous. And sooner or later, we're going to be called to take a stand. Error opens the door to disobedience, and that leads to Satan's haven. And so Babylon's evil, basically here, is religious pluralism. Religious pluralism. We have to remember what is being spoken of here. The church today, as we know it, the bride of Christ, the worldwide collection of all true believers, we're currently at war with evil. But in the tribulation, the true church is going to have already been raptured out before the tribulation starts. And this false church, this idea of religion, will be in league with the evil one. In fact, Satan himself, or Antichrist himself, even makes a covenant or a pact with Israel for 7 years, 3.5 years through. He breaks that. We talked about that already. But the tribulation, this false church, will be in league with the evil. And this scarlet heart of Revelation is accused of harlotry with the nation. This will not be an abandonment of religion. Now catch this. It's a sinister amalgamation of religions designed to hide the truth of the gospel. The spiritual harlotry of Israel, spoken typified in the book of Hosea, but in other prophets, wasn't that they abandoned the law of God, but they synergized it with the worship of Baal. And I think I spoke last week or week before that. In northern Israel, they found up in the region of Dan or farther north towards Lebanon, they have found the ruins of what was the pseudo temple that the rebel 10 nations of Israel, once they had the civil war, split off and built another temple similar to the ones in Jerusalem. Except for in the northern temple, the ruins, they had a large altar that was where they sacrificed their lambs and their goats and their bulls to Yahweh, to God. Right beside that, a smaller one, they would sacrifice their children to Molech during the same worship service. And I cringed even saying those words, but I saw that altar that was there, and it just horrified me to think of what was going on. The religious pluralism at its finest, or at its worst, I guess it'd be the better way of saying it. So the Antichrist will be the leader of this false religion. Now catch this. This is kind of the mantra or the mission statement of this false church. All are to be tolerated, but the intolerant will be eradicated. All religions, all pathways to God are to be tolerated. But if you show up as a believer in Christ, a person who accepts Christ during the tribulation, takes a stand for Jesus and Jesus only, that makes you intolerant of any other pathway to God, because Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me. That makes you intolerant, and they will eradicate you during the tribulation period of time. Religion will no longer be in competition with the world during the tribulation. It'll actually be a requirement. In this amalgamation of world religions, the purity of the church will be turned into what is vile. Evil will no longer be an enemy. It will become the resident within the church. Yes, there will be a one world government. There will be a one world currency related to the mark of the beast. A one-world religion with Antichrist on the throne. So, in the broad strokes, Christianity in a broad sense, the Roman Catholic Church in a broad sense, even Islam in a broad sense, could very well be honored synergistically. We just kind of combine them all, tolerate them all, and they eventually, because of the pluralism, will worship the beast as a part of their religious pluralism. Eventually, in the latter part of chapter 17, we read last week that even this religious pluralism, this false church, even that won't be tolerated. Anything but pure devotion to Antichrist and Satan will not be tolerated, and then talk about how they're going to destroy this. And it's a picture of how they destroyed or demolished this scarlet harlot. Today, religion is used, unfortunately, for a political gain globally. Today, religion is used for financial profit, and this will be the real mode of all religions during the tribulation. So let's bring it back to where we are today. Pure devotion to Jesus and Jesus alone. And I'm not going to define what that is. I mean, that's not something that because as soon as I start defining, you say, yeah, but what about? You and God walking straight together with detachment from the influence of the world. In this process, God is saying he's going to destroy this religious pluralism. He's going to destroy Babylon and all that it stands for. Now, if you go back to Revelation chapter 18, the next section talks about Babylon's evacuation. I heard another voice from heaven saying, "Come out of her, my people, so that you will not participate in her sins and receive her plagues." Verse 5, "For her sins have piled up as high as heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities." He's saying to the people who have become Christians, during the tribulation, and they will be living or they will be present in the city of Babylon, or they will still maybe start to dabble in this pluralism. He's saying, come out. He's asking for an evacuation of these believers. I remember back in 1980, some of you weren't born yet. Some of you were, a few of you were. But in 1980, remember Mount St. Helens? Those of you who were alive during that time? Well, there was a resident there at Spirit Lake, a fellow named Harry Truman. No, he wasn't our former president. This was a fellow named after our former president. But oh, Harry Truman had been a resident of that area for many years. And there was an order because of the pending eruption of Mount St. Helens that what they were fearing might happen, that everyone should evacuate the area. And most everybody left. But Harry said, "I have lived on this property my entire life, and I am not moving." He refused to evacuate. Well, Mount St. Helens blew up and blew a third of a mountain 8 miles high in the sky, and a lot of them landed on Spirit Lake and just completely decimated that area. And Harry Truman refused to evacuate, and he died. He didn't do anything bad, necessarily. He wasn't the cause of this. Yet simply by his proximity, he died. So this passage here in Revelation 18, verses 4 and 5, is a plea for God's people to leave religious pluralism. In the geographic sense, leave Babylon. But spiritually speaking, also, move as far away from religious pluralism as you can, from adding anything to your simple, pure faith in God. Even today, there's true believers dabbling in pluralism. I'm not going to ask, but read your horoscope. Live by the fortune cookie at the restaurant. We're taking stuff and we're just adding little tiny things to what our true faith in God says. And God says, don't do that. Come out from that stuff. In fact, the call is to come out. The call is to leave. The call is to get away from. There's a massive call to detach oneself from any form of compromise, taking a radical leap and severing ties with it. Whether it's being caught up in the system, come out. And so it's basically this whole call to evacuation is a calling out. And if we refuse to leave, that's where the problem is. Very interesting. The word church in the English language comes from a Greek word, ekklesia. And that word ekklesia is made up of two Greek words. It's a compound word. Ek means out of. Klesia means to call. So the church is made up of the ones who are called out of the world. Now, it doesn't mean that we have to become hermits and live in the mountains. Although I've been to some of your places up in the mountains, and that's pretty nice up there, and I probably didn't want to go back down to the valley. But he's not saying isolate yourself from people, but he's saying, spiritually speaking, isolate yourself from the impact of the world. Don't dabble in that junk that's out there. You could even find that junk in the mountains. Ecclesia, be a called out one. Now, kind of a parenthetical warning, either those reading John's message before the actual fulfillment were kind of the intended audience, and that includes us as well. So if we refuse to shed our ties with pluralism, we face our consequences in two ways. Number one, so you will not participate in your sin. In other words, there's a call to say that I need to separate myself from this religious pluralism or religious dualism or anything that violates my pure standing with God. And there have been people who have been rock on, right on with God, followed him faithfully, and then they'll make a little compromise. Then I've talked to Christians. I've talked to some pastors before who have said, yeah, I used to believe everything that is said in the Bible, but I've come to really understand at a deeper level. Somehow they're better because they don't believe the Bible, because they go deeper. And there really isn't a hell. There really is an eternal condemnation for those who reject Christ. Eventually, because of God's grace, everybody is going to be saved and enter God's greatness in his kingdom forever. How could a loving God send somebody to hell? That's sick. That smells like smoke. Smoke comes from fire, and fire burns forever in hell. But they've just slowly gotten to that point. Ecclesia, come out. And so if we don't, 1 Corinthians 15:33 says, do not be deceived. Catch this. Bad company corrupts good morals. So who I hang out with, yes, I want to be an impact. Yes, I want to have an influence. Yes, I do. But if I'm beginning to let my guard down, I'm beginning to dabble and take on stuff of the world, that company will corrupt good morals, and I begin to play the religious pluralism game. So one of the reasons he's calling me to make a line in the sand between true faithfulness to Jesus and dabbling with the junk in the world is that so that I won't participate in her sins. I won't participate in that whole process. But number two, that's one of the reasons that I am to be called out, so I won't participate. But number two, so they don't receive her plagues. It's called guilt by association. It goes with that age-old saying that it's not so much that you're guilty, but you hang out with those who are, you're going to look guilty. Sooner or later, the hammer is going to come down on the wayward from God. Sometimes, in a joking way, somebody says something, and they didn't realize they said it, but just kind of a passing statement, but it's really theologically way off the wall. And I jokingly will step away and says, I'll tell you what, when the lightning strikes, I don't want to be anywhere. That's not going to happen. Well, I haven't seen it happen yet. It could happen. But the idea is that you don't get subject to the plagues of that. Eventually, there will be a judgment. Do not be associating with those earmarked for judgment. Listen to what I just said. Do not be associating with those who are already earmarked for judgment. The Passover blood was seen by the death angel, and those who were under the blood, not under the influence of the surrounding area. This plea will not be heard in the tribulation. It's And not only will be heard during the tribulation, it is heard right now. Come out. Come out. We're called out of the world system. Don't be dabbling with stuff that's not biblical. And then number three, Babylon's equity. Babylon's equity. Now, equity means it's accumulated value, it's fair, it's just. Some of you who have a mortgage on your house, it's possible to take the equity, or that which you've already paid for, or the value of your house above what your mortgage is. That's called equity, and some people will draw money out from that for a variety of reasons, maybe buying another piece of property, or maybe doing a remodeling project. But equity is that value, that accrued value that's there. Now, how in the world could Babylon have any accrued value? Well, let's just use the word equals. In fact, verse 6 talks about the equity. Equity can be good, or sometimes equity can be bad. Verse 6, pay her back, even as she has paid, and give back to her double according to her deeds in the cup which she has mixed. Mix twice as much for her. So Babylon's equity is, she's building an equity of sin. Scripture talks about storing up the wrath of God. Every sin, every disobedient action stores up the wrath of God. Not been revealed yet, not been revealed yet. There's a spiritual, sinful equity that's building up for Babylon, even yet today. And God says, eventually, pay her back, even as she has paid, and give back to her double according to her deeds. The equity of Babylon has basically accumulated sin. And we know that the wages of sin, or the equity of sin, is death. Not just a physical cessation of your heart and respiration, but it's an eternity separated from God. Now why? He says twice as much. Isn't that a little over the top, some would say? Because so many were deceived and abused in the name of God and the church. Religious abuse even takes place today. People trusted the influence of a religious leader. People in the days of the tribulation will trust the influence of an authority. People were led astray by her by a sham and falsehood. And double should be her equity. First for her own sin, and second for the deception that she led others into. Verse 7. To the degree that she glorified herself and lived sensuously, to the same degree, give her torment and mourning. For she says in her heart, I sit as queen, I am not a widow, and I will never see mourning. Boy, how arrogant. When the echo of the words of this Babylon city, of the scarlet harlot, the whole idea of religious pluralism that Satan is wanting to energize, when it sits there, and I rule it all, and it doesn't seem like up till that point that anything was going to keep her accountable. She glorified herself. Glorified herself. Glorified. That's taken place before. Oh, yeah. In Isaiah 14, starting in verse 12. How you have fallen from heaven, O star of the morning, son of the dawn. You have been cut down to the earth. You who have weakened the nations. Now this is a Isaiah prophecy about the past of the devil and the future of Antichrist. You have weakened the nations, but you said in your heart, I will ascend to the heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God, and I will sit on the mount of the assembly in the recesses of the north. That was Satan's original sin. I will be like God. I will ascend or pass over God. God says, there's one boss and you're not it. Nevertheless, you will be thrust down the Sheol to the recesses of the pit. And so this whole idea that Babylon and religious pluralism seeks to exalt themselves, they glorify themselves. But if you go back to Revelation chapter 18, verse 7, that she lived sensuously, deliciously, needing nothing, when she was full of abundance. And that's quite a comparison that in during the dark ages, when people were suffering with disease and poverty, that was when some of these cathedrals in Europe were built and just glorified and honored. A few years ago, Marilyn and I had the opportunity to go on a vacation, and one of those areas included Italy. And we went to Rome, never been to Rome before. And so we're looking at the Roman Colosseum and so forth, and then one of our visits was into the Vatican. And the opulence there was incredible. This great big dome over the center of the Vatican just was encrusted with gold letters and huge amount of opulence that was there. And one of the security guards that was there, I said, "How long has this Vatican been?" "Oh, for hundreds and hundreds of years." And I said, "Well, if that's the case, how could the church afford to build such an opulent edifice when the world was so poor, the people were so strikingly in poverty?" And the security guards, "Well, that's easy. We sold indulgences." Now, what that means is that part of a fundraising method that the church used in that time, an indulgence. What's the word indulgence mean? It's that second and third and fourth rule of the chapter 30, expecting no consequence. And so the indulgence is that if you just make an extra offering to the church, we'll write you a certificate of indulgence. So that affair you've been having, we'll write that off. In fact, you can do it for Uncle Louie, who passed away a few years ago and is probably now burning up in purgatory. You can buy his way out. And they sold these certificates, and that's how they raised the money. And I was shocked that the security guard was so blasé about it. "Oh yeah, we sold indulgences to help build this." And the people would scrape together all they had to falsely buy their way out of a sinfulness that only the blood of Jesus could ever do. And that it did not just stop there. It has gone on and on and on. Living sensuously. Sure, we can blame the Roman Catholic Church. We can blame TV evangelists. I've heard stuff on TV, some of these TV evangelists, that I'm shocked, I'm surprised that God didn't strike him with a lightning bolt, or maybe a falling lamp or something when they were saying some of the things that they did. But they're living sensuously. And then thirdly, in this one area, she said, "I sit as queen." Now, there's a kind of an asserted crown that's not really granted here. The arrogance of this false church. She's lifted herself up to royal status, again, kind of saying, "I'm the queen of heaven." And this false church, this religious pluralism, will impose its religious pluralism on the people and say, not only here is what you should believe, but you must believe it. And if you don't believe it, you can't do business without the mark of the beast. And part of that was worshiping the beast. Allegiance or annihilation? It's not the fault of those who seek. It's the problem of those who lead. And then she makes that final statement, "I will never see mourning." And it's not mourning what happens first thing of the day, but "I will never see grief. I will never grieve. I will never have to. In the process, I will never mourn. I am above the law." That's why I don't watch the news anymore. People think that they are above the law. "I cannot grieve for that which I am ultimately not responsible to. Amidst all the pomp and circumstance, the power of absolute authority eventually is going to come." And verse 8 says, "For this reason, in one day, her plagues will come, and pestilence and mourning and famine, and she will be burned up with fire, for the Lord God who judges her is strong." A little side note here is, you reap what you sow. May not happen right away, but it does happen. God is just. God is good. all the time. Wait for somebody to say it. God is love. God is merciful. God wants you to avoid the judgment so bad. He wants you in heaven with him so bad that he loves you so much that he gave his one and only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Here it is. God wants us to spend eternity with him. But until then, he wants us to experience the very best here, aside from the religious pluralism that our culture is basically practicing now for the tribulation. Don't be a part of that rehearsal. I want to be practicing for heaven. As we look at the taken home section at the end of our message here, there's 2 points, and usually I have you read something, or I do something first and read something later, but we're going to reverse that order. First, read Psalm 1 every day. It's 6 verses. I know you can do it. You can read them in English, you can read them in Russian, you can read them in Spanish, whatever language works for you. Read it, Psalm 1 every day, and as a result of that, repent and return. This makes us find that avenue of escape from any element of pluralism that I have inadvertently stepped into and gotten entangled with. Read Psalm 1 and then repent and return. And just do that every day. It's real simple. You can write in repent and return in your Bible if you want to, right next to Psalm 1. And that's a natural application as you walk your way through that. Let me close this part of the service by reading Psalm 1. It talks about a man here, but we're talking about a human, not a male. Okay, so this includes you ladies too. Blessed is a man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners. You see the pluralism in there? Nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He's like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, which means the wicked will not stand up or withstand the judgment, nor will sinners be in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Would you pray with me, please? Father in heaven, this is heavy to consider the ultimate and final judgment that you would have on the city of Babylon, on the system of Babylon, and on the people that choose to associate themselves there. Lord, help us this week to see how we can separate ourselves from any aspect of the world that has crept its way into our faith and our behavior. Help us to live a life that is wholly pleasing to you. And help us have enlightenment and power as we read through Psalm 1. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us, please? live. Amen.